Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 18th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. The first item on our agenda is for members of the committee to consider whether or not to give to take in private agenda items 3, 4 and 5. Are members of the committee agreed? We all agreed. I should also record that we have apologies this morning from Colin Beattie, member of the committee. What we are planning to do this morning is to hear evidence on the Audit Scotland Accounts Commission Section 23 report into early learning and childcare progress on delivery of the 1140 hours expansion. To that end, can I welcome our four witnesses this morning? First of all, the Auditor General, Stephen Boyle, joined us, and the Auditor General is accompanied by Tricia Meldrum, who's a senior manager at Audit Scotland, Rebecca Smallwood, who's an audit manager at Audit Scotland, and I'm also pleased to say we're joined this morning by Sophie Fleming, who's here from the Accounts Commission. It was a joint report by the two organisations, so you're very welcome. We've got quite a number of questions to put to you on the report this morning, but before we get to questions, Auditor General, can I ask you to make a short opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. Delighted to present this joint report that Audit Scotland has prepared on behalf of myself and the Accounts Commission on funded early learning and childcare. From August 2021, the number of hours that eligible children are entitled to receive annually increased to 1,140 or 1,140, as is more commonly referred. The report today provides an update on expansion progress and outlines associated risks that were covered in our 2018 and 2020 report. Our audit report found that the Scottish Government and councils, allowing for the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic, did well and delivered the expansion by the revised deadline of August 2021. Councils had completed most of the infrastructure projects required and significantly expanded the workforce. Take-up of funded ELC by 3- and 4-year-olds remains high, and most parents are happy with the flexibility available. More 2-year-olds are now registered for early learning and childcare, but many more 2-year-olds are estimated to be eligible and not yet receiving funded places. The Scottish Government and its partners have made progress with data sharing arrangements that will allow councils to identify eligible 2-year-olds. The sector, however, remains fragile. The report highlights that some risks have changed since the expansion came into effect in August 2021. There are budget pressures on the Scottish Government and councils, workforce pressures, including the sustainability of funded providers such as private nurseries and childminders, risk limiting flexibility and choice for families. This is important to achieving the intended policy outcomes. The Scottish Government invests around £1 billion annually in funded ELC, but the report highlights that there are complexities in apportioning spending specifically to the expansion. The Scottish Government plans to assess the value for money of the expansion as part of its next phase of evaluation. Convener, we have again highlighted data gaps. There have been further delays in developing software needed to improve the management and monitoring of ELC services, and there continue to be gaps in data that impact on planning and monitoring, including whether funded providers pay the living wage across the ELC service. It's too early to assess whether the expansion has led to better outcomes for children and increased opportunities for their parents to work, study or train. The Scottish Government has developed plans to evaluate the impact of this expansion and collect the necessary data. Baseline data has been gathered. The impact of COVID-19 will make the evaluation more challenging. We intend to come back to funded ELC with future audit work to examine the impact that the policy has had on outcomes for children and their families. Our report makes recommendations to both the Scottish Government and local authorities. As you know, Convener, I'm joined by Rebecca and Tricia, who were part of the audit team that produced the report. I'm delighted that Sophie Fleming from the Accounts Commission is here with us to answer the committee's questions. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much indeed. Can I just ask my first question on that last point which is you make clear in the report that it's too early or you're not yet in a position to make an assessment around the impact of this policy. What do you envisage your timescale being for being able to do that?
So we haven't nailed that down yet as to when that will take place. I think what we've done today and what we say in the report, it remains our intention to do further audit work at the right time. This is the third report, as I mentioned in my introductory remarks, and given its significance, both in terms of the impact that it will have on outcomes for children and young people, really part of that continuation of early intervention, preventative spending to deliver benefits in the long term, both for young people and families, we'll give that careful consideration together with the Accounts Commission as when it's the right time to do so. Probably it'll be sometime over the next few years. Difficult to be more precise than that, Convener.
Okay, thank you. And because we can see that there are staged approaches to the rollout of this by age, for example. So it will be interesting to see where that gets to. One of the other things that, by way of introduction, we wanted to ask you about was, so you indicate in the report that, roughly speaking, expenditure in the year that you've looked at was about £1 billion of public money. What is the projected funding figure for future years?
I'll bring Rebecca in a moment just to say a bit more about kind of what that means. But so there is some volatility, I think is the point I would make, and that brings a degree of risk to the future. So around £1 billion is spent annually, and I'll come on to say a bit more. I'm sure the committee would be interested in that, the precision with which the expansion of early learning and childcare cost isn't there because of some of the complexities around the collection of information between councils and the submission to the Scottish Government. What it means for future budget provision will be a matter of policy choice for government, scrutinised by the Parliament, as to how much it intends to spend. So we know the commitment remains to deliver future early learning and childcare, but the actual amount that's being spent is reducing slightly because of projected changes in the number of children and young people accessing the service. Rebecca can say a bit more about that, Convener, but there is some volatility both in the short term but also really significant choices that will have to be made both by councils and the Scottish Government amongst its other priorities. Rebecca.
So we set out in Exhibit 2 the funding allocations that have been made by the Scottish Government for ELC to up to 23-24. That's the only year for which we have information. We don't know at this stage what the arrangements will be for 24-25.
But that's a flat cash settlement, isn't it, in that Exhibit 2? Am I reading that correctly?
So there's two aspects to the funding for ELC. So some of the allocation from the Scottish Government goes through core funding for councils, and that reflects the historic arrangements that were in place to fund the 600 hours of funded ELC, which was prior to the expansion was the number of hours that children were eligible for. The second part is a ring-fenced grant. It's a specific grant for funded ELC, and that was intended to fund the additional 540 hours brought in through the expansion. And there has been some change in that over the last couple of years. So as we set out in the report, in 22-23, it was £15 million less than it was in the previous year. And in 23-24, it was £9.1 million less than it was in 22-23. So there was movement in that specific grant, but the core funding has stayed the same.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to say a word more, and actually I'm Sophie might want to say a bit more just about what it means in terms of councils' funding and the kind of some of the wider challenges that councils will have. But so Rebecca's right, there's two components. There's the ring-fenced element for the expansion, and then there's an indicative allocation within the wider funding to councils. And that indicative component that's allocated notionally against early learning and childcare has dropped by 14% in real terms. So there's an element of protection in terms of the expansion ring fence grant, but the indicative bit isn't protected, and that's really the kind of choices that councils will have to make as amongst their other priorities. So they really, it applies the same to the Scottish Government as it thinks about its priorities and choices through its allocations. But I'm sure Sophie wants to say a bit more about that.
Yeah, thank you, Stephen. I think you've covered the most. What I would like to add is obviously that the complexity is by design, because the initial, it's not quite discretionary, but the initial 600 hours and the entire design is meant to pick up local differences so that councils have the flexibility to respond to their local needs in the way that is best suited to the needs and the changing needs of the population. So I suppose adding the complexity of the geographical spread, urban, rural, and so on and so forth, the predictions in terms of what the intake will be in terms of, you know, children eligible for the policy, but overall also that the budget is pre-primary education. Rebecca will keep me right on this. So it's not even that it's just ELC. So within that, there's also then things about, you know, wraparound care or some additional spend around additional support needs and so on and so forth. So I suppose the big takeaway from our side is it is complex. It's complex by design, but also there is that absolute data need in terms of getting the clarity.
I mean, if I reflect on some of your earlier reports, I mean, there were concerns, weren't there, about the extent to which the expansion was going to be fulfilled because of delays to the provision of new buildings and the refurbishment of buildings, because of concerns about whether the increased level of staffing that was going to be required to deliver this expansion was going to be met. So when I read this report, I was quite pleasantly surprised that that appeared to have happened. But was that, you know, when we talk about this £1 billion of funding, is that revenue funding? Does that include the capital investment that's been required to increase the capacity of the sector, in the public sector, for example? Could you maybe break down those different components for us?
Yeah, I'm going to bring Rebecca in, actually, just to say a bit more about the split of capital and revenue. And again, there's an element of not all of it's funded. So some councils, as it was set out in the report, have had to or chosen to use their own capital funding as they've increased the supply of buildings. And there's some, you know, useful examples across Scotland where different councils have done so. But if I can step back just to your wider point for a second, Convener, before turning to Rebecca, is that this is a positive story from our perspective and that of the council, because I'm sure that councils and the government have done well. That's our key message, to get the necessary infrastructure just about in place. You know, so there are, I think we said about 90% of the intended buildings are in place. The provision is still being met across the country with some contingency arrangements while remaining capital projects have to be completed. And the necessary workforce is also in place to deliver it. Yes, risks remain, but in terms of the delivering what was anticipated with the extension as a result of the pandemic has been met. Rebecca can say a bit more about the nature of the funding that was used relative to budget as she wishes.
So the £1 billion, around £1 billion, is the allocation from the Scottish Government for revenue funding annually. So that's how much is spent, or that's how much is allocated on an annual basis for revenue. The capital funding for the expansion was separate. There was an agreement to provide £476 million between 2017-18 and 2020-21. So that was the capital funding for the expansion. And as we highlight in the report, councils are projecting as at August 2022 that they would spend £598 million on capital for the expansion. We also get into the report that there are a number of reasons why that projected figure is higher than the allocation itself, including some of the projects that councils have included in their projections were not intended to be funded through those allocations. We also know that there will be more up-to-date information available on this. So our report highlights the position at August 2022. That was the most recent data available to us at the time of doing the audit. But the Scottish Futures Trust gathers information from councils on this on a reasonably regular basis. And we know that there's just been another data collection in May that they're working through at the moment. So we're expecting a more recent figure to come out shortly, which we'll be looking at also.
Right, that's great. That's really helpful. And other members of the committee have got questions about the financing arrangements and staffing levels and so on. So we will come on to those. But I want to turn now to Craig Hoy, who's got a question for you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Ball. We note that the legislation and the associated statutory guidance places an emphasis on what I think is described as flexibility and choice for parents in terms of how they access early learning and childcare. But that degree of choice is very much determined by local authorities themselves. Could you just maybe flesh out a little bit, to what extent can parents access early learning and childcare outside their local authority? Should that local authority not be giving the flexibility and choice or the patterns of childcare provision that they might need?
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Hoy. I'll say a word or two, actually, and I'm going to bring Sophie and Rebecca in just to say about, you know, council's choices and what options they have, as you ask. Flexibility is absolutely recognised both in the legislation and the report. At a high level, parents are saying that they are happy with the expansion arrangements, but not everybody. You know, so there are some people who haven't got, you know, what they wanted in terms of provision, and you know, some of that is reflected in the report, the reasons behind it, in terms of whether they got the provider they wanted, the location they wanted. That's not all spelt out in the legislation to say that everybody's going to get exactly what they want. So that you'll get the provision, but not every need of yours will be met. As it relates to what happens next from that, you know, what onus is on a council, because you know, the legislation was set out, it's for the council to be the lead in the provision and then using funded providers accordingly. Risks from that we'll come on to, but I'll turn to Rebecca and Sophie. Maybe Sophie might go in first, actually, and just in terms of kind of what that means for councils' roles, for how they bring out and sustain the sector.
Thank you. So overall, I think, as Stephen has highlighted, what we refer to in the report is data from the Scottish Government. So there's a survey of 8,000 parents, and it's, I think, 88% of the 3 to 5-year-olds were happy with the allocation. It's higher for the eligible twos. So again, the baseline value, it seems to be broadly working for the needs of most, but not all. And there's always then the significance on who the remainder is, which isn't our data. I think your question was specifically about flexibility across councils. Did I get that right? So to my understanding, there are agreements in place, because you will have situations, East Renfrewshire, Glasgow, and so on and so forth, where place of work and residence will be different. But I'll bring Rebecca in on the details on that. But I think there are agreements in place. But obviously, the planning is made much harder if it's not your own local population, which I think brings us back to the predictions and the need.
Yes, Sophie's right. There are cross-boundary arrangements in place for councils. Part of the funding follows the child guidance, has put that in place. So the councils should be able to offer people who ask for a place in a different council area that option.
Great. Mr. Ball, you alluded to the fact that most parents seem satisfied or content with the arrangement. I'm going to use an example from East Lothian, where the parents weren't happy, which was there wasn't the council, for perfectly valid reasons, cancelled a contract with an organisation called Bright Stars Nurseries. Immediately, or within a period of weeks rather than months, parents had to scramble to get their children into the available nursery provision, which was in the council provided provision, which was very, very strictly determined around a model that was highly inflexible in my view. Given that you've identified that there is effectively a funding shortfall here, in the sense that the councils are being asked to do more with less in relation to the financing for this, is there a risk that effectively the buck is being passed to councils here, and that actually flexibility is really just affordability, what is affordable within any given area, and the flexibility for councils that have the resources can be offered to parents, but councils that are squeezed, and that's the vast majority of councils, if not all, are having to come up with very rigid models. So people's working patterns and behavioural patterns have to fit the model of provision rather than it being the other way around.
It's quite a lot in your question, Mr. Hoy, actually, so I'm going to kind of share that around with colleagues. I think Tricia may be helpful setting some of the context for around quality. I think you're referring to, and some of the criteria that the government and councils using the care inspectorate assessments of quality arrangements. So Tricia can cover that. In terms of the funding arrangements, I'm going to say a word about that, but I think, again, probably all of us will want to say a word or two about your question. There's a range of views about the extent to which funding is sufficient to meet the requirements. So, as I mentioned a moment or two ago, funding levels are changing, dropping slightly in years to come. And the government's position on that is, well, that's reflects their modelling that there's going to be a reduction in the number of 2, 3 and 4-year-olds who will be accessing the service, and therefore that's a linear relationship. Causal and council's perspective, it's more complicated than that. That, you know, some of their costs are fixed and it's not going to be as quick to allow them to vary provision and their cost base as quickly as, you know, the annual allocation. So there's a range of perspectives on it. I'm not close to the detail of the case that you mentioned in terms of the circumstances of a particular private provider and what it means, but I think it does speak to some of the wider point that we make in the report about some of the fragility within the sector, that if a particular provider, whether it's as a result of, not speaking about that case, I should say, but a quality issue, that a judgment from the care inspectorate, that the responsibility remains with the local authority to secure the provision. And given we set out in aspects of the report about rising costs, inflation, workforce pressures, and some of the movement that's talked about between private providers into council providers, not always consistency of terms and conditions, can make it more challenging for some of the private providers to sustain their business models in light of these changes. That's at a high level, Mr. Hoyer. I'm keen, maybe first of all through Tricia and then broaden out to others.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you. Again, not getting into the specifics of the individual nursery or the individual council. The requirement on providers is that they do meet the criteria set out in the national standard, and that covers sort of 10 elements, but a number of those elements relate to the scores that they would receive on care inspections, and that they have to achieve scores of good or better on the 6-point scale that's in place through that kind of quality mechanism. So if a provider doesn't meet those criteria, meet that standard, then they have an improvement, a period of time to improve, to put in place improvement plan, have a re-inspection. So again, at that point, if they still don't meet the quality standard, then that would be where potentially they would no longer be able to provide funded early learning and childcare. So that's the approach, is very much through the care inspectorate inspections and the gradings that a setting would receive.
I think so. Tricia has set out the detail. Overall, Stephen has said it, for what the scope of the audit, what we looked at. We clearly say the Scottish Government councils have achieved their goals, but we also highlight the risks that I think you're pointing towards around workforce and the next steps. So I think we're quite clear in the report about that we need a more certainty on data to tackle the issue which is being addressed. Overall, there is, as was referred to beforehand, there is the question of how allocations work on a local level, and the complexity there is then obviously that you have different settings, private, the statutory provision by councils themselves, which in a way are more immediately manageable, but also childminder, so again, a different model of provision. So I suppose in terms of flexibility, councils have it in their grasp, depending on the private provision available, to offer parents a wide array of choice. But obviously that is contingent on those private providers, be they childminders or private nursery, to be there. To a certain extent, again, coming back to the numbers, I think there's a question in all of these terms around flexibility and need. They mean different things to different people. So this is not to say anything. Obviously, you're example shows the validity that expectations weren't met. But I suppose from the point of view of the policy and what we were looking at, the overall intention is being delivered. So there is a range of options. They may, however, as Stephen has pointed out, not always meet the specific individual family's needs as these things unfortunately come and go. So I wonder whether, Rebecca, you've got anything else to add on the flexibility forward-looking.
So councils consult with parents, and they should do that every 2 years, and that should be used to inform the models that they then offer. But as colleagues have said, that doesn't necessarily mean that the models on offer will meet every family's needs. Those models should reflect the results of the consultation, but that may not work for everyone.
I just do wonder whether or not councils, given the financial constraints, are basically providing what they can provide rather than looking at what parents actually need. But just in terms of the whole system, Mr. Ball, is there a risk that councils as providers and the rule setters and they determine the rates for the PVI sector, is there a contradiction or is there a conflict of interest within this system that the Scottish Government has overlooked, perhaps?
I think there's some... The sector is changing rapidly, I would say, Mr. Hoy. So, you know, so in terms of this new legislation, the expansion, the rollout of 1140 has had, you know, a significant impact on the sector. You know, we've mentioned to the convener's question, there's been a significant investment in infrastructure, you know, new buildings, supply. Workforce has changed fundamentally. 8,000 new people, you know, working in this sector. On top of that, some of the business models will have been disrupted from the private providers. So there's a real change there. We talked about in the report, there's an expectation that the living wage will be paid, different terms and conditions existing across providers, and also some of the statutory responsibilities remaining with the council. So whether it's the flexibility is on offer to all, probably not. I think it's set out in the report. I'm not sure I would say it's a conflict of interest. I think what is effectively saying, there's a statutory responsibility and there's an expectation that there is a requirement in different parts of the country for a mixed market to operate effectively, because I think it's some of the risks that we set out in the report. If there is, you know, a failure of a private provider, and the example that you mentioned, that the responsibility remains with the council to provide that service. And that's not going to be straightforward for councils because, you know, not all of the provision would be available. So there needs to be a mechanism between Scottish Government, local authorities and private providers to work towards a stable provision across different sector settings. Maybe one thing that is really important, I suppose, is, you know, we talk about in the report, and actually I'm going to bring Rebecca on some of this if she wishes, about kind of measures of the stability of the sector. There's a stability survey that's carried out that assesses how the volume of people who are remaining in posts each year. And then on top of that, there's work that's been undertaken by the government about a financial health check of the private sector providers as well, awaiting conclusions upon that. So I think it's not the case that we say the government and land councils aren't aware of these issues. They very clearly are. What we're seeing at the moment is they're working through that. And as we can think about where that leads us, is that once we're clear on the valuation arrangements, the totality of the investment is the right point for us to come back in. So we're watching this carefully, but I'll bring Rebecca in first of all.
Yes, so the financial health check is something that the Scottish Government have done in previous years, and we understand that there'll be more information available on that in the summer. And essentially that is looking at the sector as a whole. So it's broader than just ELC. I think it will also include out of school care providers too, but it's looking at the sustainability of the sector, and we expect that there will be actions associated with whatever comes out on that in the summer. The stability index is a measure, so that's something that's been looked at in the absence of good data on the movement of staff. So we talk in the report about the potential movement of staff from funded providers into council settings. But there isn't a great sort of information on that. But what we do have is the stability index, which basically looks at whether someone's still in post after a year. And that is consistently higher in council settings than it is in funded providers.
Thank you.
may just briefly add, Mr. Hoy, I think down to your question, we make the specific recommendation in the report that this data needs to be accessible. We need to be able to make a judgment call on it. Obviously, there's a lot of anecdotal evidence, which is not dismissed, and we make reference to that, and indeed in the audit work, where it pains to have those conversations with providers, charities, and so on and so forth. But the message, as Rebecca has just alluded to, is quite clear that that data needs to be in place, it needs to be comparable to answer your question specifically about movements between sectors and therefore the stability or, in fact, the interplay of where councils sit.
Thank you. Okay, thanks. We've spoken a little bit already about flexibility and outcomes. And one of the outcomes I think that was expected, that I think there has been some measurement of, was around because of this increased provision for preschool education, that it might lead to parents and carers taking a decision to defer their children going into primary school. But I think on the evidence that you've produced in the report, that doesn't appear to have happened to the extent people may have expected. I mean, could you say a little bit more about that? Have you got any understanding of why that is? Is it a cultural thing? Are there other factors at play that that mean we haven't seen choices being made that are there for deferral of children going into primary school?
Yeah, you're right, Convener, and colleagues again want to comment. I think just in terms, we cover this at paragraph 20 of the report. I think the there was concern initially that if there was an increase in deferrals, and parents have the relatively straightforward option to defer entry to the start of school for children whose birthdays fall in January, February, before the start of the cut-off for the school year at the beginning of March, and options like, you know, with further discussion for birthdays that fall in December and before that. That hasn't been as much as was anticipated, because the concern would have been that more deferrals would lead to more pressure placed on early learning and childcare settings. There's some further work that's underway in terms of pilot activity, just reviewing that impact in more detail with that report as awaited, Convener. Again, I'm just maybe bring Rebecca in if there's any kind of more detail to share on that.
So the pilot actually published on the same day that we did, so we haven't included any of the findings in our report, but we have now seen it. So the legislation on deferrals is changing from August, but in advance of that, 10 councils were piloting the new approach that would let the children with birthdays after August up to December also defer. And what we've seen from the pilot report that came out was that there's some evidence of a sharper increase in deferrals in the pilot areas compared to the rest of Scotland. But essentially, it's difficult to ascertain a specific trend. I think more it concludes that more data is needed in future years. Partly it's complicated because of COVID and the impact that has had on deferral rates more broadly. So assessing whether it's the result of the pilot in those areas rather than the impact that COVID might have had on parents' opinions about whether to defer their children or not is difficult to disentangle. So they are monitoring this data going forward as well. What it highlights is that there were some localised capacity issues, which we did highlight in the report as well, but it hasn't been a more widespread issue, although I think staff have some concerns that might change going forward as it becomes perhaps more widely known about from parents, that there's a risk still to how that works in future.
And so the report into pilots, who produced that report? Was that produced by the local authorities? Was that produced by somebody on behalf of the Scottish Government?
Yes, it was commissioned by the Scottish Government and they published it.
So have we had any response yet? Do we know what actions the Scottish Government is going to take in light of the report into the 10 pilots?
Haven't seen any actions from the Scottish Government, but the report has now published.
Okay, well, that's Auditor General.
I think that's something we can take a further look at if need be. And some more, we'll come back to the committee.
Thank you. I think that would be helpful. One of the things that we were also interested in is, of course, we speak about the expansion to 11:40 hours, but it's not mandatory. I guess we just wondered whether you've got any data or you've done any work to understand why parents, carers maybe exercise the right not to avail themselves of the 1140 hours.
You're right again, Rebecca, who's on top of a lot of the detail on this, we'll kind of set that out for the committee. I think it's absolutely the case, convener, that it's not mandatory. You can't force parents, carers to engage children and young people in preschool education. That's not to say, though, that there's not seen significant changes in behaviour and volume of registrations. 3 and 4 year olds is one part of it, but I think it's also important to recognise that for the policy broadened out the statute provision for 2 year olds as well, vulnerable 2 year olds, with the intention, again, as part of that theme of earlier intervention, preventative spending, to deliver longer term outcomes and objectives. In terms of the reasons why some people don't engage, they'll be wide and varied, and the report covers that, and Rebecca can say a bit more. Much of it will come down to parental choice, activity. Some bit will be about flexibility that we've touched on with Mr. Hoy, that actually just the provision doesn't suit individual families' circumstances. That will always be a factor, but I think the legislation is clear that they will not be able to meet every single family's choices. But Rebecca can take the committee through that.
So, as the Auditor General says, we know that the uptake is higher for the 3 and 4 year olds, and the 2 year olds tends to be the area where you can see that there are more children eligible than are accessing the service. One of the main barriers that's been found previously, and I think we've included this in our previous reports to the committee as well, in terms of 2 year olds accessing the service, is that councils don't know which families are eligible, so it's difficult for them to promote the uptake to the families who might be entitled because they don't have information on who those are. And that's an area where we've highlighted in the report we've seen some positive progress this time round in terms of the data sharing arrangements that are now being put in place to allow councils to access information on who specifically in their council area might have an eligible child, so that councils can then contact those families and let them know that they are eligible. And then they can make a choice as to whether or not they wish to take up their place. And that's something that the new legislation that was brought in October is allowing that data sharing to start. And we just had an update that we saw yesterday suggesting, so in the report we're highlighting that councils will be able to access the data once the governance arrangements are in place. And we know that 15 councils now do have access to the data and have got those arrangements in place. That's the most recent update.
Okay, thank you. I've just got one final question before I bring in Willie Coffey, and that is, again, in the report you refer, I think, paragraph 25, to satisfaction surveys of parents in consideration of the flexibility of the arrangements and so on. And I think, if I read it correctly, there was a much higher satisfaction rate amongst parents or carers where the children were living in households where parents were not at work, for example, or also living in the more deprived areas. There seemed to be a higher satisfaction rate. I mean, again, have you got any rationalisation of that? Could you perhaps enlighten us as to why you think those are the results that you've come across?
I think it would be in the realms of speculation, convener, as to kind of why. I could offer a thought in terms of why it wasn't as high, perhaps, the converse in families who are working, perhaps. Is those families that require on that precise provision in a particular location to support their requirements. Families who weren't working, maybe the provision is closer to home, offering more choice as distinct from and more open to flexibility. What we do say really matters now, that when the government is how it's using this information as part of its longer-term evaluation, that they are capturing families' views, the outcomes that it's leading for children and young people. And also, one of the recommendations we make in the report, and I'm sure Sophie might want to say a bit more about this too, and it's of keen interest to her, is they're taking children's views into account as part of the evaluation, Article 12, UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, that they're engaging properly with very young children who are using this service to part of their wider evaluation as a key next step for the government and their partners. But it would be speculation in terms of the earlier part of your question.
But was, I mean, was there quite a wide variance between those different groups of households? Because again, I mean, one of the stated and I think agreed public policy objects of this expansion of early learning childcare is about increasing levels of economic activity, isn't it? And so, if it's not serving the needs of parents, carers who are at work or want to go to work, then that's a public policy issue as well, isn't it? Which needs to be addressed.
Yeah, very, very clearly, Convener. When just moving into the evaluation section for a moment, and again, Sophie, I'm sure we'll want to say a bit about this too. Looking at the arrangements for evaluating the success of this policy, the value for money that's been achieved, the connections to the national outcomes, what we've seen so far is positive from the government's perspective. They've captured baseline data, and their approach to evaluation, as they've set it out, both in terms of the aims of the evaluation covered paragraph 98 of the report, and then the individual measures that they'll look to assess and the detail of those at paragraph 99 of the report. Very clearly, one of the stated aims was to increase economic activity for families of low income or not working. So the signs are positive, and with some caveats, and Rebecca rightly mentioned some of the progress in terms of data sharing, which was one of the barriers, and especially the earlier the intervention, the more likelihood of longer-term success. And if that's not achieved for vulnerable two-year-olds, the long-term implication of that is much more significant. So that data sharing is in place is really positive. So the building blocks are there, I think it's what we're seeing at the moment, but lots of work still to happen before government councils can take an informed view that this has had both the benefits to children and young people in terms of outcomes and also the economic success of the policy as well. Sophie.
Briefly, and thank you for bringing in the UNCRC in Article 12. I think this is, and the team will keep me right on this, but this is obviously the third audit in the series. And when we started, the focus was very much on quality, as it should be. So the experience of the children, the outcomes for children, and therefore, I suppose you can see where potential trade-offs or the complexities lie in making that work, because it's sometimes maybe not quite aligned with parental or let alone workforce needs. So I think there's a tension, again, where that will be difficult to manage, and it will be looking differently for different families. Overall, however, I think we need to bring it back, and we make the recommendation to involve children. They were, if I'm not mistaken, involved. There were two settings that were at the very beginning, at the inception of the policy, involved early year settings, where children and parents were consulted on how best to go about the expansion. So I think there's good foundations to be built on moving forward. But then also, obviously, there's quite a lot of work in the charitable foundation sector, looking at specifically, I suppose, your question around the differential experiences between the eligible twos and other children. So I suppose the foundations are there, and hopefully in the next audit we will be able to answer that question more precisely, because it is, just to reassure you, a keen interest of, if I can speak for Stephen, the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission, that we really, really come back with an answer to the question, has it worked, and on what levels has it done that?
Yeah, yeah. Of course, not all other things will be equal over that period of time either. So, but I think it's still very useful to have those assessments over time. Willie Coffey's got some questions to bring in. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, everyone. I wonder if we could stick with our very young friends, our two-year-olds, for a moment. Stephen, your report tells us that 25% of two-year-olds are eligible, but that's going up. The numbers of two-year-old families presenting their two-year-olds wishing to take advantage of the policy is going up, probably because of the current economic circumstances. Have you got any sense of whether this is uniform across Scotland or other pockets of Scotland where it's much more of an increase in an uptake demand than others?
Yeah, I'll bring Rebecca and Sophie in just to say what information we have about the geographical implications, but you're right in terms of the that population group is liable to change very directly in terms of economic circumstances, and all the more reason, therefore, that the data is clear and the policy objectives that accompany it are likewise, Mr. Coffey. But again, I'm bringing colleagues in if we have that geographic information.
So the difficulty with that is that we know that 25% of children are estimated to be eligible, two-year-olds are estimated to be eligible, but it is an estimate, and that comes back to the data sharing issues, that it's only an estimate of how many children are eligible. We don't have that broken down at a council level, so although we can, there are statistics published by the Scottish Government in terms of uptake through their census, uptake of two-year-olds, and so that is available at a council level. The extent to which that reflects the number of eligible children, we can't differentiate that, but we are expecting that there will be, that the estimate of the number of two-year-olds hasn't been updated for some time because it relies on information from HMRC, DWP, to estimate how many children in the population might be eligible. That's something that the Scottish Government are going to be able to refine as a result of the data sharing arrangements with councils. They'll have a better sense of the numbers of eligible children and be better able to compare that with the uptake to get a more accurate measure there.
As that increases, that demand increases, there's bound to be a consequential impact on the funding needed to support it, or is it unfair to say that at the moment?
I think, again, Sophie might want to say sorry about more about this, but I guess we see in the report there's different views about, as the policy becomes more mature and is implemented, that the facility, the infrastructure is in place, whether there's a direct relationship between the change in young people accessing the service relative to the funding that goes alongside it. Causal and others make the point, well, just about the costs don't follow each other directly. There are fixed costs that you can't change just with the volume, but it's something that really needs to be worked out. As Rebecca mentioned earlier, just that clarity of how the cost relationship works with individual places, Mr. Coffey.
Mm-hmm. And your report also talks about some work going on to try to help the councils to identify the eligible two-year-olds, and there's some work going on between Scottish Government and HMRC, some technical work. That's not the same as the software issue, I think, that we might talk about later on. It's a different piece of work, I understand. But has that been concluded? Is that technical ability to identify eligible twos complete? And have councils got that? I think you said, Rebecca, that 15 councils are starting to reach out. When will the rest of them start to do it to identify the eligibility?
So that it's just a case of the individual councils need to put their governance arrangements in place. So the software that provides them that information is available. It's called Data Pipeline, I think. And as soon as councils have their kind of information governance arrangements in place, they can access the data. So the remaining councils are just going through that process. We don't have an update on timescales for the ones that are outstanding still.
OK, I might come back to that when I ask you about the other software component that's coming later on in the report. Just a wee final query from me on access to the provision with kids with additional support needs. I mean, the satisfaction rates are pretty high. Your report tells us it's 88% broadly, but 85% satisfaction amongst families with kids with additional support needs. Is there a story to tell or that you could share in there about whether we're delivering fully for families with kids with additional support needs?
Yeah, I think there is a bit of a story again. Sophie, I'm sure, wants to comment on this. It's one of the themes of the report, I'd say, Mr. Coffey, about in totality, this is a good news story, but there are still risks around data. And this is an example that it is difficult for the government and councils to assess fully the extent to which children with additional support needs are accessing the expanded service. This is done through the use of census data rather than in aggregate. I think there are connections to the point that you're making about the quality of IT and software provision. Totality was designed to provide better monitoring planning information to support councils, and with children with additional support needs would very much be one of those. But it doesn't detract from the overall point you make that, you know, 85% of parents, children with additional support needs, are satisfied. Where they weren't, there was kind of commentary around staffing not being fully or appropriately trained, some aspects of lack of support, concerns about communication or about the hours that were being provided. Something of a, you know, and there will always be concerns from individual parents, you know, but whilst there's a general high level of satisfaction, there is still more work to be done in this area.
And that work is being undertaken to try and improve, perhaps, if it's training that was the biggest element of those concerns. Is that work being undertaken in your view right across the board?
Colleagues?
So I can't give you a clear answer. I think I want to add to the complexity that will that training be delivered in some places? I'm sure it will be. But when you then come back to the local spread, so in terms of the workforce adequately trained, the provision available with the right hours, we'll probably have a different picture across different areas of Scotland because of workforce issues. So I think in terms of the risks we identify, we will keep a very close look at precisely these questions, these, I suppose, cross-secting complexities going forward. So additional support needs, geography, workforce, and so on and so forth. I think as far as we can tell from the data that we have, and Stephen has already pointed out that we would like to have, you know, we're looking forward to having more. It will be one of the key things in the next report, as in when we're ready to do so, to come up with a very firm question, answer to your question in terms of where is what delivered and what are the specific plans. But councils are definitely wanting to address the need. I mean, there's no doubt about that.
Thank you very much for that. I'd certainly like to see the picture as it emerges, council by council area, if that was at all possible, Stephen, and any future update that you might give to the committee. But very happy with your responses so far. Thank you, and I'll come back later on if I can on the software issue that you're also raising in the report. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. And Willie Coff is also the deputy convener of the local government committee, so he's got a particular interest in seeing how that spread works. Can I just return very briefly to infrastructure and capital spend and so on? So I think in the report you talk about completion rates, and I think you said that the completion rate had risen from 87% to 95% over the course of the year that you were looking at. I mean, what is the current completion rate?
So I think you mentioned 95% by August 2022,
yeah.
Convener, and then a projection from all projects to be completed by 2025. Colleagues might want to say a bit more about the detail that sits behind that. I think paragraph 40 of the report, we give a bit more flavour as to, you know, which local authorities have experienced delays and some of the reasons behind those. Before passing over, I think the thing to say is that although not all the projects are completed, all the service is being provided, just not in the new place that was intended. So it's not like there are families, children, young people who are waiting for a building to complete in order to receive a service. Contingencies are in place, the service is being delivered, just not yet in the new building. So if we have any more detail beyond the 95%, I'll pass colleagues to bring. Maybe go to Rebecca first.
So no, this is linked in with the monitoring that the Scottish Futures Trust does on the capital spend. They also monitor progress on completion, so we know there will be more recent information. It's coming out soon, but we haven't seen the May data collection yet, so that's still being worked through.
Oh, okay, thanks. Can I come on to something which is an increasing part of our agenda and questioning, which is about net zero targets? And so we've seen this significant capital infrastructure investment, primarily in new buildings or in refurbishment of existing buildings. To what extent were net zero targets set around these infrastructure projects, either by the Scottish Government or by the Scottish Futures Trust?
Yeah, again, I turn to colleagues with a bit more detail, but I think it's a really important point, Convener. Actually, we've first of all referenced some work that we've already done and further work that we have planned in this area. Paragraph 42 of the report firstly notes that there were some additional measures with the capital investment, such as insulation and to help councils in individual projects achieve net zero aims. But the committee will be familiar with the report that we recently produced on the Scottish Government's arrangements to support net zero and the need for additional emphasis to be placed therein in governance, risk management, as part of the leadership that they're providing across the Scottish public sector to ensure that infrastructure projects are factoring in net zero ambitions. We're also at the stages of planning some further audit work on how that is progressing in terms of, is there a clear connection between infrastructure activity and net zero being at the heart of that? So we're looking to bring that to the committee later this year. As it relates to these infrastructure projects, I suspect that it will be a mixed picture in terms of whether net zero was an inherent factor in some of the infrastructure developments. If colleagues have more information, we can share that. If we don't, we can come back to you in writing.
So I don't have the specific dates to hand, but I think my understanding is that the capital allocations were based on a metric that included specifications for insulation, but I think my understanding is that that might have predated the net zero. So this is going back to sort of 2016-ish. It was in our first audit, I think, which published in 2018, but I think that was based on some of the information. So I think it might have predated it, but some councils have then subsequently changed their arrangements, as we've highlighted in the report, and that has changed the specifications they've used relative to the metric that was used to allocate the money.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just reflecting on the report, Auditor General, that you referred to, which you brought out earlier this year, where you reminded us that a climate emergency had been declared in 2019, and we're 4 years down the line. In an emergency situation, you know, what urgent action has been taken? And, you know, has anything been included in construction specifications around new public infrastructure, which recognises the seriousness of the emergency that we're facing?
I think you're quite right, Convener. Those were the overall judgments that we were making, that there was a lack of clarity in terms of how the Scottish Government was arranging itself as part of its system leadership role to deliver net zero targets, a stronger focus on climate emission reductions and not adaptations, all of which will be relevant. As it relates to individual projects, I'm sure Rebecca's quite right that there'll be a timing difference. What we're also planning to do is further audit work in this area, just to examine how well the climate emergency is then translating into individual projects, sectors, and what that means over the course of the rest of this decade. So we have work in progress on that front, which we'll bring to the committee.
Thank you, and we'd be keen to hear the results of that investigatory work you're doing. I've got one other question before I bring Sharon Dowie in, and that's, again, something which we've spoken about in other contexts at the committee over the last couple of years, certainly over the last year or so, and that's inflation, especially in the construction industry. And I think in paragraph 43 of the report, you refer to a concern which has been expressed by councils that construction inflation is estimated to be around about 30%. And I suppose the fairly obvious question is, what is being done in terms of the allocation of funds to address that?
So you're right, 30% is the figure that we quote in terms of the impact that inflation has had on capital projects. We've seen over the past 6 to 12 months the impact that inflation has had in a wider setting, both in terms of pay inflation, cost of materials, cost of purchasing goods and supplies. How that's translated into individual allocations is less clear. It's not going to be enough to meet that, Convener. So there are factors in why, in the report that we set out, that the cost of delivering the projects is, if I get the correct, in CapEx terms, funding of £476 million was allocated. Spend is just shy of £600 million. There are a variety of factors behind that. One will be inflationary cost increase, And the other, I think, as Rebecca mentioned earlier, is that councils will have had licence to vary the spec of their particular projects as well. There will be a debate about funding. I know Sophie is close to and may wish to say a bit more as to how that... But what we're not seeing is the Scottish Government funding councils to the totality of what they've actually had to spend to deliver the projects. So, and there's, as I mentioned a couple of times already, there is, you know, further debate between government, COSLA and councils about where that should best land. But Sophie can say more, I'm sure.
Yeah, I think I would just want to add to what you've already said, Stephen, that there's maybe in that definition of the reporting in which this just over 100 million overspend is coming from, there's some projects that weren't originally budgeted and meant to be in the reporting, but because of the delays of the implementation of the policy, because of COVID, have been included. So I suppose there's been a moving picture in terms of the overall budget, which may make it harder to make that assessment whether the increase is solely due to inflationary pressure or rising costs, or indeed higher specifications. So I think this mixed bag that, unless Rebecca, you've got any further data, I think wasn't the focus, but it will be about disentangling, if that's even possible, those various factors. But Rebecca, if you've got any more detail.
No, that's just a complex picture.
I mean, and for reasons of transparency, if it was possible to disentangle any of that and to understand what the different drivers of inflationary costs were and what was happening to the overall capital settlement, that would be useful. And presumably it would be useful for local authorities in order to help them prosecute their arguments for perhaps additional funding.
Quite. So it's not something we have to hand today, Convener, but... And it may be that it's something that the committee might wish to explore directly with the government and individual authorities.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm going to turn now to the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, who's got a series of questions to put to you. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning. Your report highlights significant recruitment and retention challenges for the ELC sector. And we note the Scottish Government is working with stakeholders to draft a strategic framework for the ELC and school-age childcare workforce and an associated action plan to address the challenges, and it's due to be published in summer 2023. To what extent will the development of this framework and action plan address the challenges the ELC sector is facing, and is it on track to be published this summer?
Morning, Deputy Convener.
Morning.
Again, Rebecca will want to say more about what we know about the extent of progress to compile the strategic framework and action plan. Workforce is a very strong theme in our report. I would say that, as I mentioned earlier, 8,000 additional people are now working in the sector, but it is still fragile. And one of the biggest risks will be about the sustainability of the workforce across different providers. We've talked about factors behind that in terms of cost of living, whether there's consistency of terms and conditions between council settings and private providers, and wider aspects about the availability of workforce, its attractiveness as a place to work relative to other options will all have a bearing on the sustainability of the sector and helping the government and local authorities meet the wider objectives that this hugely significant investment of public spending to deliver the longer-term outcomes. Before passing to Rebecca, I think one thing just to draw the committee's attention, this is one of our key recommendations for the Scottish Government in today's report, that they work with councils and their other stakeholders to develop a long-term workforce plan to tackle some of these risks to sustainability, modelling and targeting what future demand. As Sophie and others have mentioned, it's very clearly part of our further follow-up and future audit work to see, you know, how that comes to fruition. But I'll bring Rebecca in just to say more about the framework and action plan.
So we haven't seen any of the draft actions that are part of their strategic framework. So we don't know what that will cover at this point in time. The most recent update we had from the Scottish Government at the time of clearing our report with them was that it would publish over the summer. But we haven't seen a draft to be able to comment on the content of what that will include.
Right.
The actions.
Are we confident that it will come out in summer, or?
That's the most recent update that they've given us.
Right, okay, right, thanks. paragraph 49, page 17, states that similar to the findings of the last audit, representative bodies of private and third sector ELC providers continue to report that their members have challenges in recruiting and retaining staff. Can you set out in a wee bit more detail why staff stability is higher in council settings than in the private and third sector? And if there's any more detail on what the Scottish Government can do to improve stability across the sectors?
So there will be many factors. One behind why people choose to work in a, with a private provider, run private businesses, or decide to work in a local authority setting. Terms and conditions will be a key driver behind that. They're not always the same. One of those is about the extent to which private providers can or are choosing to pay living wage arrangements as well. So you'll see, Deputy Commissioner, one of the points that we make in the report is that there's not enough data about whether living wage is being paid by all private providers. That level of clarity needs to come. Rebecca mentioned earlier on this morning about the stability index is one of the mechanisms used to assess, you know, whether people are remaining in post for a year or more, and there is variation. So it looks like to be that there is more stability within the council setting, less so within private providers and third sector providers as well. The factors behind that aren't clear enough. You know, there is one of the gaps that there's just, this is based on index and national monitoring. The Scottish Government has recognised this and is working with the Scottish Social Services Council to try and get better data to look beneath more of the trends for why people are moving between different sectors. Again, that's going to be really important intelligence as they, you know, as we expect to implement our recommendation and a detailed workforce plan that takes account of the different sectors that are providing services.
Okay, thanks. You mentioned on it earlier on as well, moving on to funding for ELC, that there isn't a comprehensive picture on how much councils have spent specifically on the expansion at national level. And you've obviously mentioned there's other various complexities as well which exist, which can make it difficult for the government to establish the overall amount spent on implementing the expansion from 600 hours to 1140 hours. Does that mean that we might never know the cost of implementing the policy?
Again, I'm sure want to say a bit more about the set out for the committee, how we're in the circumstances, but what we've reported in the report is that at a headline level, the Scottish Government doesn't know specifically how much was spent on the expansion of the programme for the additional hours up to 1140. There are complexities in it. Some relate to data, some relate to IT, the way that information is reported by councils to the Scottish Government through local financial returns. But it's also the case that this is the third time that, you know, in this of events that the Scottish Government hasn't yet received the information that it needs. It's too early to be definitive, I think, to answer your question directly, whether, you know, we'll ever know. The Scottish Government does have plans in place. I mentioned to the convener earlier about it secure more baseline information. Its evaluation arrangements are in the right place in terms of whether the policy at a high level will deliver value for money. Mm-hmm. It's going to make that assessment based on pre-pandemic provision and spending through to outcomes and spendings next year and beyond. But it is an important factor, Deputy Convener, that you're highlighting, that that level of precision information isn't yet available. Rebecca and maybe Sophie want to say a bit more about why these are the circumstances that we're in.
So the councils report what they've spent through the local financial returns or LFRs, and the way in which those are set up, councils report on pre-primary spending. That's the closest that we have to funded ELC, but it can be a bit broader than just the funded ELC offered through the 1140 expansion. So it also includes council spending on other ELC that they might offer families. So they might choose on a discretionary basis to offer additional hours to some families. They might choose to offer hours to families who don't meet the eligibility criteria for two-year-olds or for younger children as well. So pre-primary spending is potentially a bit bigger than just the 11.40 hour. The other complexity with the LFRs is that it doesn't differentiate between what was spent on 600 hours and what was spent on the extra 540 hours that was brought in through the expansion. So we don't know what the split was. The expansion was phased in by councils over a number of years, and so we can't work out how much was spent on those extra 540 hours over time. That's the bit of the expansion that we don't know what was spent on that. It's complicated for councils to do that. So they took a range of approaches to piloting and phasing in the expansion. So in some councils, and I think we highlighted this in our previous report to the committee, in some councils, they chose to offer it in some settings, not in others. As they began to phase in the entitlement, they took approaches to best suit their local needs. So they have all taken a variety of approaches. But in some councils, they chose to incrementally increase the number of hours that children got. So it went from 600 to 800 and then went up again to 1,000. So there's a variety of different approaches, and that adds to the complexity of councils being able to split out that money. That was one of the issues that the Scottish Government have requested councils provide them with that information. So separate to the reporting that councils already do through the LFRs, the Scottish Government had requested information from councils on a number of occasions to try and gather that information. But there were a lot of data quality issues that mean it's still not possible to get that national level picture. I think part of your question also related to whether it ever will be possible. Yeah. What we do know is that the Scottish Government have got plans to look at value for money of the expansion, but they'll take a different approach to that, so it won't be able to sum up the total of what was spent on phasing in the expansion. What they will do is they'll look at, well, what was spent on providing 600 hours of funded ELC in, I think, 17-18, and they will be able to look at the outcomes that were being achieved for children and their families at that point as well, because they've got that baseline data that they've been gathering through the Scottish study of early learning and childcare. So that's gathering the outcomes information. So they'll be able to compare the costs and the outcomes at that point in time for 600 hours with the costs and the outcomes that are going to be achieved in 23-24. And they'll be able to draw a comparison between those two points in time to look at value for money.
I think if I may just add, obviously, the complexity thrown in there is, as we all know, the pandemic. So whether, you know, how you account for the effects of the pandemic in terms of outcomes, I think it's the right approach to take, looking at best value in that sense. But we will have to take that with a caveat, as within every other policy, that we are looking at a different status quo that we expected in 2017-2018 when the baseline was taken. So I suppose that's one of the additional complexities that's layered on top.
Thank you. It's complicated then. In the last question, paragraph 64, the report states that the Scottish Government allocated £9.1 million less to councils for funded ELC than in 2022-23, and that COSLA is concerned that a reduction in funding may affect service delivery in the future. To what extent do you share COSLA's concerns?
I'm sure Sophie from the Accounts Commission will have a perspective on that as well. I don't think we've reached a judgment on it yet. What we've really is, I guess, is reporting that there are different views in today's report between the government and COSLA as to whether or not the funding that's made available and the model is right. I think it's mentioned to Mr. Coffey earlier that COSLA and Council's perspective is that it's not a linear relationship. You know, so actually, there are fixed costs that can't vary with changes in funding that's more connected to individual child places. So we've not reached a position, or I've not reached a position on that, Deputy Convener. I think that is likely to come as part of our next stage, really the adequacy of the funding model alongside whether it's achieved outcomes for children, young people, economic activity from families, alongside that kind of wider value for money judgment. I think we're recognising that it's a factor that needs to be resolved between government and COSLA in today's report. Sophie.
Thank you. Just to add, I mean, the we're coming back to the complexities inbuilt and trying to respond to in local needs. So I think COSLA is suggesting that obviously the picture may not in all cases mean that a reduction in children, as Stephen has pointed out, will actually on a per capita basis lead to the same reduction in cost, and Stephen has listed all the various factors in that. But obviously that's highly dependent on the local provision. So it's, as with many things, it will not be uniform across the board. But I think what we are clear on in the report is that the financial pressures, without a doubt, are high, and that's for the Scottish Government and for councils. And Rebecca has set out the complexities that go beyond the expansion, which is ring-fenced in terms of the initial 600 hours and then the discretionary spend to respond to local needs. And undoubtedly, as councils face difficult choices, that will be part of those difficult choices as well. So we are acutely aware, and I think we highlight that these pressures need to be discussed, addressed, and that both local authorities and the Scottish Government need to work together to start with the right data to make informed choices about how the difficult decisions that lie ahead will be met.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Craig Hoyer had some questions earlier about the sustainability of providers, and he's got some more questions on that. Craig.
Thank you, convener. And just to delve a little bit deeper into this whole issue about the sustainability of providers, particularly those in the independent sector. You report that there's no national data available on the demand for childcare across both funded and non-funded ELC, and that you recommend that the Scottish Government addresses this gap in data. What work do you understand that the Scottish Government is presently undertaking to address this recommendation?
So you're right, Rebecca might have an updated picture on that, Mr. Hoy, but there are data gaps throughout the report. This is one that needs to be tackled, really, so that the Scottish Government and councils have a more rounded picture of the drivers between what's going to be the sustainability of private providers. I think, as we've touched on already this morning, that you know, in the event of provider not being available for whatever reason, whether it's, as Tricia's outlined, whether it's quality factors or financial factors, there's still a statutory provision to provide this. And that will be very challenging for local authorities to step in and make that provision. Perhaps speaks to the example that you raised earlier. So in terms of having a wider data, now that's key to understanding the scenario planning that they'll need to do. Part of the workforce recommendation that we've made fits neatly alongside that. But I'll bring Rebecca in to say more for the committee.
In terms of our specific recommendation on measuring the demand, our understanding from conversations with the Scottish Government, I think, is that it is considering how to address that recommendation, but I'm sure the Scottish Government would be able to give you a more up-to-date picture, potentially.
I think, Sophie, I think you used the word anecdotal evidence earlier in relation to what's happening in the marketplace at the moment. And I get the impression that the independent sector is squeezed, and the expansion in care, given that they do not feel they're being adequately funded for providing that care, means that their opportunity to turn a profit, which is effectively why they are in the sector in the first place, is being squeezed into that wraparound or the effectively breakfast clubs, you know, after hours provision, etc. So to what extent are you getting the impression that the independent and private sectors are starting to shut their doors and move out of provision? And is there a risk that that's going to feed through to put more pressure on councils to provide that provision?
So a couple of factors. So I think, as I mentioned earlier this morning, the market has changed fundamentally with the provision up to 1140 hours. That has a bearing on private providers' ability to vary their income. Significantly, you mentioned a couple of areas that they're able to do so. And there will be relevant factors behind that, also attributable to cost of living, the desirability to work in local authority setting for staff relative to private providers. But there is some emerging evidence about, I suppose we talk about, the fragility in the report, the phrase that we use, Mr. Hoy, just about the number of childminders operating in the sector has fallen by 29% in recent years. We set out paragraph 53 of the report that childminders are reporting there are recruitment and retention challenges. Some work underway, there's pilots being undertaken about looking to expand the role and in other parts of Scotland, particularly remote and rural communities, within that almost 60 new childminders had completed or applied for registration with the Care Inspectorate. That goes some way to addressing it, but in the round, these are the issues that the government and councils need to address, that there's a sustainable market provision, because it speaks to the point you raise in your question. If that's not addressed, then the provision comes through to local authorities who may or may not have the workforce and the facilities to offer that services to families.
Yeah. You slightly preempted my next question in relation to remote and rural areas. Obviously, childminding is a critical part of provision. And to give an example from the Scottish Borders, for example, the Scottish Childminders Association has said that the workforce in the Scottish Borders has declined by 43% over the last 6 years, and that this could double by 2026. And that's presently affecting 386 families, with 56 businesses having withdrawn from the sector. That will obviously have in those rural areas major implications. So to what extent is childminding, which is already a Cinderella service, at risk in Scotland as a result of 1140?
So the first thing I should say is our audit hasn't looked at individual areas. I think we're taking a national perspective. But really, I think some the figures speak for themselves. But there are a 29% is the national picture in terms of the reduction of childminders. And that risk undoubtedly will be higher in remote and rural areas. So there are risks in totality to the provision of the service. Just to repeat the phrase that we arrive on, there's some fragility here for private providers, both nurseries and childminders, as you say, that requires real careful consideration by the Scottish Government and the and local authorities in Scotland, that they have that sustainable mixed market provision that can deliver the 1140 expansion. We make recommendations to that effect. We reference the pilot activity that's being undertaken. These are the kind of steps that government, working with our partners, local authorities, have to get right with the private providers.
Yeah. And just to return to the Scottish Borders, the Scottish Borders Council funded a childminding link worker, which the childminding sector said to me was vital in their operation. That funding has been withdrawn because of the pressures that local authorities are facing. So to what extent is the wider financial environment within councils, for example, those link workers or those outreach workers that operate between councils and the independent and voluntary and third sectors, is that at risk, and could that also then mean that there's going to be greater pressures washing back upon councils?
Yeah, I mean, Sophie might want to comment on councils' positions in particular. The thing I would say is that there are financial pressures. There will have to be choices. Both the Scottish Government will want to make in terms of the delivery of its policy intent, and similar for councils too. So how that feeds through into individual posts and choices will be policy choices for these organisations. But workforce financial pressures are two of the very clear risks that we set out in today's report. Sophie.
I think you've summed it up. I mean, that there will be pressures and there will be questions of priorities. We highlight that they will be difficult. They're not for us to come, and they will be depending on the individual circumstances and individual councils. But your examples highlight that, you know, we keep coming back to this complex picture, just how complex and interconnected it is. And it goes beyond the expansion, where in childminding, you know, we've seen a trend over years. And Stephen has pointed out to the work that the Scottish Government is doing with the Scottish Childminding Association, that commissioned in 2020, I think, the, you know, sort of a root cause analysis in terms of what issues are, not just in terms of losing childminders, but also in terms of registration. So I think people are talking about where solutions could lie, also across inspectorates, so colleagues from the SSSC, and the care inspectorate will be involved in these conversations. Whether that's at pace with where we're going in terms of future policy change, I suppose that's not for us to comment on, but actors are aware of, as Stephen has termed it, the fragility, and are moving to address those. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Before I ask my next question, I'd better remind members of my register of interests, because I want to ask about the living wage and fair work practices. So you remind us that there has been established an ELC living wage and fair work implementation group. You've also mentioned earlier on that there's a paucity of data about the living wage and whether or not it's enforced. I mean, doesn't that organisation have in its terms of reference some responsibility for getting that data? I mean, it's an implementation group, isn't it? So presumably it needs to have the data to understand whether or not the promises that have been made are being kept.
I'll bring colleagues in, convener, if we have any detail on the terms of reference of that group in a moment. I know the specifics of it, but what we have reported to say that the application of the living wage, and some of that will be reflected in requirements of local authorities for providers, is a significant change for some private providers as well. That may, and you can tell from my language, I'm using terms that it reflects that there's just not enough data on this, and this is one of the factors that we draw out in the report, that there needs to be better information, given how central both private providers are to the sustainability and delivery of the service. There needs to be better data to understand what impact that's having. You see that we're drawing on survey information about sustainability indexes to assess the overall movement of different of workforce in different sectors. That needs to be a clear action coming from today's report, that there's far more clarity on what impact terms and conditions are having, and the application very specifically of the living wage across different providers. Can turn to colleagues if we have more detail on the specific of your question.
So that group will be developing an approach to monitoring the living wage. It just hasn't happened yet. So we highlight in the report they were due to discuss that at their next meeting, but we haven't seen the minutes of that yet to see what progress there has been made. We also highlight that some information on living wage will come through the financial health check that we've discussed already this morning. So that's due to come out in the summer. There'll be some information coming through that, and we also do know that some councils are doing it themselves locally, but there's not a national picture for us to report on at the moment. That's why we've made our recommendation that this needs to be monitored and the information gathered.
Okay, that's helpful. And does that sense, because the terminology we're using here is living wage and fair work, and so presumably fair work covers things like the use of 0 hours contracts, for example. It covers things like the right to trade union membership and trade union recognition and so on. I mean, is that something which is going to be monitored, and is data going to be collected on that?
We would expect so, Convener, because the government, with its fair work principles, has the ability to set that out clearly in its expectations in terms of its procurement requirements and its guidance to councils, whether that's part of the budget allocation, the ring fencing conditions that go alongside it. As Rebecca mentions, it's something that we'll factor into our own consideration as part of our next audit work. And again, if I may, it may be something that the committee wishes to explore with the Scottish Government.
It's a very clear answer, which is very helpful. Thank you. I'm going to turn now to Willie Coffey, who's got some more questions to put to you. Willie.
Thanks again, Convener. Stephen, you referred earlier to a piece of software that was in development and stopped being in development, let's say, but I'm not clear what it's supposed to have been doing. From what I can see in your report, data exists at a local level, but it's difficult to assimilate that and provide a national picture of it using this software, education management software. So could you maybe tell us a little bit about what it was meant to do and how work is progressing on that at the moment?
Yeah, I can. I'm going to bring Tricia in to say a bit more for the committee on really where we're at with this software, because this was the intent, Mr. Coffey, was that this was going to address some of the data gaps to support monitoring evaluation arrangements. We've covered earlier on this morning that particularly for the two-year-old group, the intent that was going to offer. But at a high level, it hasn't progressed as intended. There have been some issues with the between CMIS, which is the Scottish local authority owned company that oversees education management software, and its provider, that's resulted in some delays and some changes in grants to support the delivery of the project. I'll turn to Tricia that she can set that out for the committee.
Thank you. So the software was obviously due to be in place for the initial date of the expansion coming in August 2020, but when we last reported in March 2020, there were already delays and it already wasn't going to be available by that timescale. So part of that was around delays in signing the contract and also some of the technical issues. So it was already delayed and there's been further delays since then. So that has that kind of increased over that period, and the contract was then terminated with the third party developer in February of last year. There's now been a new grant agreed with the Scottish Government to the Limited Liability Partnership to allow them to develop some of it in-house and also be supported by third party, by external parties as well. So the last we heard was that the estimates are for the software to be complete by March 2024, but we don't know when it'll actually go live in the councils. So it means there's gaps around things like recording information on individual children. So Rebecca's already mentioned, at the moment there's data that comes through an annual census. That's at a point in time, so that would tell you how many children are taken off ELC or are registered for ELC at a point in time. It doesn't tell you about individual children throughout the year. It doesn't tell you about the characteristics of individual children to get that full picture that you really need to understand who's using it, anybody who's maybe not uptaking it as you would expect. Where might the Scottish Government want to target their efforts to increase uptake, things like that. So there's gaps in some of that data. As you say, councils are planning and managing the services, but they're having to do things in kind of workaround ways and inefficient ways, as opposed to having this software that would do it and do it on a consistent basis and provide that consistent national information.
Yeah. Was the first project, or the initial project, abandoned three years ago? I mean,
The contract was terminated in February 2022.
Uh-huh. And is the main problem the fact that, I mean, changing to a new vendor or a new software developer isn't necessarily going to resolve data inconsistency? If it's there, it's there. Is there work going on to try to make sure that the data that the local councils are collecting is in a consistent form that allows the software to present us with a national picture? Is that one of the issues that's actually at the heart of this, Tricia?
Don't think we have that level of detail. Just know it's been sort of technical issues and issues with the development of the software as such. I couldn't get into the data behind that.
I'm always curious about what the actual cause of a software failure is when it comes to the committee. But it's really crucial, Stephen, to allow us to make any progress in assessing the impact of the whole policy. Presumably this lies at the heart of it. If we're to be successful at all in evaluating impact, outcomes and so on, we're going to need to have some kind of data analytical tool like this to be able to draw on and tell us what the picture is across Scotland and in Scotland as a whole. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, I'd agree with that, Mr. Coffey. A software tool will take you so far, but if it requires human beings to enter the data and to use it properly, there is always a risk, therefore it's not applied properly, you don't get that level of consistency. We draw, just for the committee's attention, Exhibit 4, just to summarise the data gaps that already exist. And we've covered many of these, I think, on the way through this morning, that there is a need to get this right. I refer to a recent blog that Audit Scotland produced on high-quality data is essential for both the delivery, planning, monitoring, and then the evaluation of public spending and outcomes associated from it. There are next steps required, and we've kind of set some of these out in our recommendations in today's report around data. These will be crucial so that we get to the point where the government is heading, and think, you know, we would say in a balanced way that the intent with the aims and the measures that the government has to evaluate the policy are in the right place. Addressing some of these data gaps gives them the best opportunity to make that rounded assessment as to whether this £1 billion, let's not forget, in annual investment is delivering the intent.
Thank you.
I mean, data gaps is a common and a familiar story here at the Audit Committee in a number of areas. Do you think that it's fully understood your messaging to the government and its agencies about data, data quality, data gaps is fully understood and being addressed, as you've just kind of hinted at there? Is it fully understood, do you think, to enable us to develop this and get this tool right?
I'm more optimistic now than I perhaps would have been 12 months ago, that there's an improving understanding of the need for high quality data to, at the outset, I mean, it's, you know, come back, I think 5 years that Audit Scotland produced a report planning for outcomes. It just set out what's actually required for delivering policy, baseline data, milestones, effective governance, the right data to make that evaluation assessment. Some signs of progress, and only last week, Mr. Coffey, you know, a report on courts backlog that gave an example of an organisation that had used data well in difficult circumstances. So we know that it can be done. And even in today's report, examples of there is baseline data in place to form that assessment. The assessment will be better still addressing some of the data gaps that we refer.
And lastly, from me, Auditor General, our favourite subject, value for money. We are always interested in the definition of that, what it means, who sets the criteria, you know, and whether we can apply that criteria and use the data that we have to give us the answers that we seek. Where do we stand on that, do you think? Have we got clear enough criteria in place to assess and determine value for money of the whole scheme?
So the value for money is, it's a shared judgment. So, you know, for the government and public bodies and local authorities, you know, there is there's an onus on public bodies themselves to deliver value for money, a personal onus on accountable officers to deliver value for money for public spending. As it relates specifically to the expansion of early learning and childcare, we've made a positive judgment that the measures that are in place gives a very strong foundation to make that value for money judgment. Rebecca's given some of the criteria already. Just drawing the committee's attention to paragraph 99, there's a range of measures that the government intends to assess as to whether its expansion of early learning childcare has met the intentions behind it of improved outcomes for children, for their families, and also for more economic activity. Positive signs, we would say, Mr. Coffey. What comes next matters.
Mm-hmm. And just to finally emphasise that our ability to determine value for money will depend largely on the availability of quality, consistent data being gathered and being able to analyse fairly across Scotland, and within the councils and right across the country as a whole.
Absolutely. I mean, if without reliable data, you will not be in a position to make a rounder assessment of value for money.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Willie, and I'm sure that is a theme we shall return to as early as next week. But we've got one final question to put, and I'm turning to the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, to put that question to you. Sharon.
Thank you. It's on views of children, and you actually kind of touched on it earlier on. Paragraph 103, page 32, refers to a recommendation made in the 2020 Audit Scotland follow-up report that the Scottish Government considers how to include children's views in the evaluation of its policy. The report explains the Scottish Government is working with stakeholders on whether and how to do this in a meaningful way, given other research priorities and capacity to undertake the work, but has yet to finalise plans. So could you tell us, to what extent do you consider the Scottish Government is committed to seeking the views of children as part of its evaluation work?
So we think that is the case, Deputy Convener, that it's considering how best to do this, and I'm quite sure Sophie will want to come back in on this point as well, that they find a way of doing so meaningfully. And it's a very young population, mm-hmm. It's also a population that turns over very quickly as it relates to early learning and childcare. You're only spending 18 months, 2 years for vulnerable twos, you know, slightly longer. So finding a way best to do that actually matters. It's consistent with, you know, UN Rights of the Child, Article 12. So the government thinking about it, but not yet finalising the plans. It's one of our recommendations accordingly. So,
Thank you, Stephen. Yeah, I don't think we can speak to the specifics of what the plan looks like, and I suppose that's not for us to say. We've highlighted it in two reports and made it clear, and as I said in the initial the initial setup of the policy, there were consultations, but we're coming back to what Stephen has already phrased, the meaningfulness of the engagement, and I think that may be where those priorities will come in. Obviously, it's a different way of working, but I think the Scottish Government has shown, not just in the ELC expansion, but across the board, that there's willingness and in fact, eagerness to work with the youngest children as well. So I think that's to be welcomed. I leave it at that. And obviously, we've set our expectations and are looking forward to seeing what comes back. But again, to reassure you, our interest is just as much on that point as is yours.
Thank you.
Craig Hoyt's got one very final, short question.
Final, quick question. Just one question that I should have asked earlier, just in relation to the dynamic within the sector. Have you made any assessment, or is there any work underway to see whether or not, even though the independent sector is still quite large, whether there's consolidation of ownership, that those small, independently owned and managed nurseries are effectively selling up to bigger, more commoditised, cookie-cutter approach companies? And is that part of the market fragility, that the ownership of them is in far fewer hands now?
No, I don't think we have done any evaluation on... No, just checking with colleagues. No, we haven't. As to whether or not that is a factor, it probably wasn't one of the criteria with which we drew the fragility judgment, more right. about the availability of staff, some of the remote rural factors, the change in composition of childminders, but and the reliability that local authorities have on them. If it is a factor, and no reason to doubt you, Mr. Hoy, that it's something that councils and the Scottish Government should be very alert to, and what influence that has on the quality and the sustainability of the sector.
Just thinking, if you lose one nursery, you lose one nursery, but if you, the holding company owns 70 and they pull out of Scotland, then that could be quite critical. Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, I would second that maybe from a slightly different perspective, but I mean, I think it's, if there is a concentration, a consolidation of ownership going on, that would be useful to have some kind of monitoring of that, because that in turn will affect the way that the sector functions and its relationship with the public sector might be too. So I think we would certainly welcome a bit more evidence on that. So, but look, can I thank you very much indeed for your evidence this morning? It's been very enlightening. So can I thank Sophie Fleming from the Accounts Commission, Rebecca Smallwood, Tricia Meldrum and the Auditor General from Audit Scotland. Thank you very much indeed for the work that you've done on this. I think it is, by everybody's understanding, an extremely important piece of policy work, and the auditing of it, I think, is especially important, and we certainly would like to ask you to give it your active consideration in the future as well, because it's an important piece of new developmental work that has got much broader implications for young people, the wider economy, and so on. So can I thank you very much indeed. I'll now draw the public part of this morning's session to a close and move the committee into private session.